Well, good morning, everybody. And good morning to those at home. I know you've not had sound until now. That's because they've not been sound until now. We're just about to begin. I've been rehearsing with the sound off. I'm looking around the room. You really have gone to the edges today. Would folks be willing to gather a little bit? Otherwise, I'm addressing a back wall. It'd be nice to have some faces. It feels like we're the survivors today. We're the ones who've made it through the last fortnight, the last ones standing. I know we do have some still isolating, others still recovering, others unable to join us. So hopefully some of those will be able to join us at home. So if you're at home, join us. Good morning. Well, welcome to our Remembrance Sunday service. I want to just kill those words for a split second if we can. Thanks. We gather. It's always a strange day today, isn't it? It's a bit of a day when we come with mixed emotions. And I don't know what thoughts, what feelings you come on Remembrance Sunday with, whether they're family members or friends that you're thinking of, stories that you're aware of, or maybe for you Remembrance doesn't mean much. We all come from different places, different times, and that's fine. But however we're feeling today, we come before a God who understands, a God who is with us, and a God who knows. He knows about joy, but he also knows about sorrow, doesn't he, and sadness and loss. He knows about sacrifice. He knows about giving his son, of course, for us, so that our sorrow may come to an end. And we have that glorious passages in the end of the Bible in Revelation. I've got Tim looking at me, and I'm trying to discern whether Tim is trying to send a signal. Still no sound. That is really odd, because I'm seeing sound on there. I'm not sure what to do, Tim. It's very peculiar. Sorry. Apologies at home if you're watching me miming to this. Where was I? Yes, we have a God who has sent his son. And in sending his son, he's identified with our emotions. He's entered into our emotions. And in Revelation, we see that he's come to transform our emotions, bringing us hope, bringing us joy, wiping away our pain and sadness and sorrows. And hopefully in that spirit we can come today, can't we? Bringing all our emotions. We have sound at home, fantastic. Bringing all our emotions as we gather in worship before our God. Shall we pray? And then we can sing a couple of songs, help bring us before our Father. 1 John 3 verse 1 says this: "See what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God." And that is what we are. Heavenly Father, we thank you that we can come before you this morning, however we're feeling, knowing that you are our Father, that we are your children, and you have poured your love on us. You have lavished us with your love, giving us everything that even in our sorrows we may know hope. And in that spirit, we come to worship this morning, offering you our joy, our hope, our fears, our memories, bringing them to you, our Father, knowing that you hear them, that you understand them, that you are with us in them. Our God, our Father. So, Lord, we come to you this morning. Amen. Amen. Shall we stand to sing?
Lord, I come to you, let my heart be changed, renewed, flowing from the grace that I've found.
in you. And Lord, I've come to know the weaknesses I see in me will be stripped away. Of your love as you live in me. Lord, renew my mind as your will unfolds in my life, in living every day. Your spirit leads me on in the power of your love, and I will rise with you. Spirit leads me on in the power of your love. So Heavenly Father, we come to you. We draw close to you. We place our lives in your hands and trust ourselves to you. Amen. Confession time. I'm feeling very rusty, and I've just realized I don't know the chord to the next song. My mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cross.
cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb. The entrance sealed by heavy stone, Messiah still and all alone. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise, O Lord. Third, a break of dawn, the Son of Heaven rose again. Oh, Trembling, where is your sting? The angels roar for Christ the King. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise, O Lord, O Lord our God. He shall return in robes of blazing sun shall pierce the night, and I will rise among the saints, my gaze transfixed in Jesus' faith. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise, O Lord, O Lord our God. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise, O Lord, O Lord our God. O Lord, O Lord our God. O Lord, O Lord our God. Yes,
Lord, we praise your name. We praise you because you are the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. A God of love, consistent in faithfulness, abounding in compassion, who transforms the darkness into light, meaning that even now in the midst of troubles and conflicts, we can have hope. We can stand secure. We can look forward because of you. Amen. Amen. Do sit down. So I wonder, family news. Have we any particular family news today to share? Any birthdays out there? I've lost track. I don't think I've noticed any coming around. Oh, are you putting this to the vote? Do we sing for win today or next week? Today, I think we do. Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Win. Happy birthday to you.
But as a treat, you can come back and sing Our God is a Great Big God for us next week. Fantastic. What have we got coming up this week? Well, this week is full of most of the normal things. So we have our prayer meeting on Monday morning, 9:30 as usual. We have an extra one for a couple of us. We've got a Churches Together committee meeting on Monday evening. So do pray for that. Churches Together will be thinking about a whole host of different projects. But we will be thinking partly about Christmas and the question of how can we mark Christmas this year. In a year when, as I'm sure you're aware, much to our surprise, we're still a little bit uncertain about what we can get away with doing at the moment. Who would have believed it? So pray that God would give us wisdom, that we can know best how to reach out in these strange, uncertain days. But also be looking ahead to the New Year's service as well. So just a little taste there, in January there will be a United service. What shape or form it will take, I've no idea. But there will be one in January. Then we've got on a Tuesday, we've got the drop-in, as usual. So if you fancy a light lunch, come and join us at 1 o'clock. If you don't normally come, you are welcome. It would be useful to know if you plan to come, just to help with numbers. Then on Wednesday, we've got toddlers and Bible study in the evening. Toddlers, last week we had our second attempt at a toddler service, and it was glorious fun. Wasn't it good, Edith? And we had a great time. The first time we had two guests and their parents. This week we had a room full, which was caught us quite by surprise, I'll be honest. I thought two, maybe three, four, but a room full of people. And we really enjoyed ourselves. We went hunting for silver coins, thinking about how Jesus loves every one of us. And the joyous thing for me is we weren't ashamed about who we were. There's no sense of embarrassment or fudging the stories. We were just told the stories as they were. We sung Jesus' Love is Very Wonderful, reaching almost to the ceiling, but certainly down to the floor. And just celebrated that God loved each and every one of us. And no one said at the end, we're not coming back again. We don't want to do this. Everyone joined in. So let that be encouragement to you. And one of the things that I'm being reminded frequently at the moment is when we share our faith, so often we do it timidly, don't we? We're a little bit nervous about how people might respond. Well, my experiences again and again are people are either good for you, that's great, not for me, but good for you, or fantastic, it's great to hear that, and we want to know more. Very rarely in my experience do we lose a friend over it, or do we have someone react antagonistically. So have courage. Let's be bold and share our faith, that news of God's love. And as we mark Remembrance Sunday, surely this is a day when, above all other days, and we've had the COP conference this week, haven't we? And all that debate, the wrangling around, can we do enough? And we have a message of hope, don't we? A message that God loves us and he's going to make a difference and things can change in him. Let's be bold and share his love. Got carried away there, little sermonette before we get any further. Forgive me, Tim. And so we've got toddlers and Bible study Wednesday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday as well. We have the food bank. Do pray for the food bank, another way in which we can share God's love, mainly in action this time, but sometimes in words as well with those in our community. Not aware, is there anything else happening this week? No, that's nice and easy. I'm looking at the clock, trying to work out where we are. 6 more minutes. Let's have our reading then. Our reading today is from 1 John. 1 John chapter 2, verse 28 to chapter 3, verse 10. John chapter 2, 28 chapter 3, verse 10. And now, dear children. Sorry, Tim. Don't you love that? Don't you love hearing those words today? They weren't written originally for us, but hearing that, dear children. Isn't that great? Continue in him, so that when he appears, we may be confident and unashamed before him at his coming. If you know that he is righteous, you know that everyone who does what is right has been born of him. See what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Dear friends, now we are children of God, and what we will be has not yet been made known. But we know that when Christ appears, we shall be like him, for we see him as he is. And all who have this hope in him purify themselves just as he is pure. Everyone who sins breaks the law. In fact, sin is lawlessness. But you know that he appeared so that he may take away our sins. And in him is no sin. No one who lives in him keeps on sinning. No one who continues to sin has either seen him or known him. Dear children, do not let anyone lead you astray. The one who does what is right is righteous, just as he is righteous. The one who does what is sinful is of the devil, because the devil has been sinning from the beginning. The reason the Son of God appeared was to destroy the devil's work. No one who is born of God will continue to sin, because God's seed remains in them. They cannot go on sinning because they have been born of God. And this is how we know who the children of God are and who the children of the devil are. Anyone who does not do what is right is not God's child, nor is anyone who does not love their brother and sister. I pray that God will add his blessing to this reading. Well, we're coming to that time in the service when we pause, as churches around the world will pause, just to remember those who've been caught up in conflicts, in wars past, but also present as well. We'll have some pictures to watch, and I'm hoping that those at home will be able to see those pictures as well. And as we do so, this is a real chance, isn't it, just to remember, to reflect on our lives, those caught up in the conflicts, reflect on the things that lead to wars. And maybe for us to think about the things that lead us into arguments and disagreements and tensions with others. Because doesn't Jesus say anyone who calls a friend his brother, that's like murder? Not friend his brother, that's, calls a friend a fool, a brother a fool, is like murder. There's a sense in which we are at war with each other sometimes, just in our words, if not in our deeds. So we can think about that and reflect and come with that sense of honesty and confession before our God. But as we do so, as we remember past and present, we can also pray, can't we, that God will be at work in conflicts around the world, changing them, transforming them, teaching us how to know peace, not war. And I don't know if you noticed in that reading that little phrase, the seed of God is in us. And I love that picture, because to me that talks of growth, doesn't it? Of change, of what seems dead becoming alive. If you want a little visual aid as well as the pictures, I often think of the poppy. Now the poppy has so many different things on it, hasn't it? It's got the black in the middle that talks of sin, of trouble, of argument, of war. We've got the red that reminds us of blood shed in conflict. But then we've got the green that reminds us of hope, of growth, of new life, and how God can transform what is black and take lives lost and bring life even out of the worst situations. And later on we'll be thinking about how God supremely has done that through the giving of his Son. Now, I'm going to see if I can get these pictures to work both on the screen but also for those at home. Seems to be working there and on the screen. Fantastic. Shall we stand and pause and remember? Heavenly Father, we remember. We remember conflicts past and present. We hold before you lives lost, lives changed, landscapes altered. We bring before you places in war now. Places in conflict, even today as we meet to worship you. And we come before you confessing our part in conflict. The things that we have done, the things that we have said that have hurt others, that have brought strife and division. Lord, as the song goes, forgive our foolish ways. And Father, we thank you that in the midst of conflict, and in all the worst that we can do, that we can still have hope. Because into this world, you sent your Son to enter our conflicts, our arguments, even bear upon himself the marks of them as we nailed him to the cross. And in some way we'll never understand, took upon himself the sin of the world, that in him we may find forgiveness, that through him we may know peace. And that as we stand here, even now in this world that knows no peace, we know that one day you will wipe away every tear. There will be no more pain or sorrow, and even death will have come to an end. And so, Lord, we come before you this morning and remember and find our peace and hope in you. Amen. Amen. Do please sit down. I think what we'll do, we'll pray and let the children go to their groups. They've been very good waiting with us this morning. And then I'll invite Tim to come and speak. And after that, we're going to share communion together as we finish our worship. And just for those watching on the stream, I don't remember if I put it on the email, but if we're having communion, you might want to quickly grab yourselves something you can use as bread and wine so you can join with us later. Shall we pray for our young people as they go to their groups? Heavenly Father, thank you that together we can gather as family. We began by thinking how you've lavished your love on us, you've called us and made us your children. And so we pray for our children as they go to their group now. Lord, that you'll be with them, that they may know your joy as they learn about your love this morning. And we pray the same for us as well as we stay here. Be with the leaders who speak to us, whichever room we're in. Indeed, whichever building we're in, whether at home or at the community center. May we all discover something more about you and your will this morning. Amen. 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 So if the children would like to go to Sunday Club.
Well, good morning, everybody, and isn't it good to be back together again? For those at home, well, I tell you that freedom is pretty brilliant. Yesterday was my first day of freedom after 10 days isolation, and it felt very good. I think it felt very good for Alison as well, actually, because she was having to do everything so that I didn't infect anybody, and So we were very grateful to get through that. But there is a lesson there, isn't there? Stick with it. Ed and Yelly have a great love for the Isles of Scilly. And they go camping out there when they can. But the campsite they go to is on a very small island. And it's very difficult to get a pitch. And so the way they do it, yesterday was the day when they open up for bookings, and they have one telephone. Apparently there's a lady with her kitchen table, and they have one telephone, and you can phone up on that day and make a booking. But of course, it's engaged. It's engaged and engaged and engaged. But now technology makes it so much easier, doesn't it? In the old days, do you remember, you dial and dial and dial. No more. As soon as the engaged signal comes, ping, and it dials again. Ping, dials again. Ed sent me a picture of his phone at something like 9:30, bearing in mind that this opened at 9 o'clock, and he dialed 197 times. And Yelly was doing the same. And then I've been doing Bible in 1 year this year, and I thoroughly recommend that if you want something good for half an hour a day. I went to do Bible in 1 year, and it was headed up, stick with it. And I thought, that's actually quite a great word for Ed and Yelly. And so I sent it to them, and I went round to see them a bit later because I was so pleased with being able to do anything and go and see anyone. I went and saw them, and there they were. Oh, the stress in that house. It was awful. And I was thinking, goodness me, what? You know, because last year they did it, and they couldn't get through, so they couldn't camp. But this year they'd got this tent so there they were, just... And I thought, well, you know, the Lord said, stick with it. And this morning, we started our reading. Now, dear children, continue in him. I think we'd better pray. Father, we do thank you for your word and for the fact that it speaks into our lives and into our everyday situation. And Lord, I just pray this morning that you will speak into our hearts. Help us to hear your voice. Lord, I pray that you'll take away anything that is not of you. And let us rejoice in your love and that we'll be encouraged to continue in you. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, that continue seems quite important, I think. I don't know about you, but I find at the moment the world seems full of angry people. Have you noticed? Perhaps it's the effect of COVID. But we've had politicians, haven't we, in the past 2 weeks, all jetting in and telling us that we can't use our private jets anymore. And we have to, you know, and they seem to be quite angry with each other, angry with the way we've ruined the world, angry. And then there's protesters, and they're angry with the politicians who aren't doing anything. And the politicians are angry with other politicians and so on. And then we get sports personalities. And we've seen over this past week, haven't we, some tragic things where relationships have been broken over racism and insults and bad things happen. And everybody gets angry with everybody else. And that's without even the royal family and their travails. The economy and how do we pay for... And as soon as they say, well, we'll raise taxes to pay for the past 2 years, half the world gets angry about that and says, no, you can't do that. You're conservatives. You're not allowed to raise taxes. And then you get... we've been at work. We're very busy. And we have site managers who seem to be angry. You know, why can't we have this done today? Well, you've only just asked us. No, it doesn't matter. We need it doing today. And we'll get angry if you don't. Whether it's care home workers or health professionals, policemen, activists, the whole trans debate, whatever that is, and anti-vaxxers, on and on and on. People get cross about things. One of the interesting things about... Alison waiting for an operation is every now and then there's been, you know, so many delays and MRSA and cancellations and all those things. One of the difficult things about it, you know, is telling other people. And Alison says, oh, I don't like to tell them because they get so upset, because they love her and they get upset for her. And some people don't just get upset for her, they get angry that the National Health Service is such a load of rubbish. Well, actually, the National Health Service has saved quite a few of our lives, hasn't it? And it is pretty good. It may not be as good as it could be if it was perfect, but then nor am I. But sometimes the world seems an angry place. And what does John say to us in this letter? I think in this passage there's a really important encouragement for us. Because John says, continue in him. You see, that anger out there, or the trouble that there is in the world, can cause us to despair, can't it? We can give up. We can say, well, it's not worth me doing anything special because, quite honestly, I can't make a difference. And I don't know what to do, so I'm going to not do anything. And we can feel a bit hopeless. And I know at work, we're talking to people at work or through work, there's a lot of lonely people. They say, well, we're isolating, and I know what isolation is now. Oh, it's grim. We need one another. But for people who don't have this family, isolation can be terrible. They don't have anywhere to go. They don't have anybody to phone them up or talk to them. And it can mean that people need comfort and direction. And all they see when they turn the television on or they open the newspaper is angry people getting angry about stuff. And so John says, continue in him. Don't give up. Because God makes a difference. The end of the story of Ed and Yelly was that about, I think they started at 9 o'clock and about 11:45, when they must have made literally thousands of phone calls. I hope you don't pay when you make a phone call and it doesn't answer. Goodness me, if it does, then you won't be able to afford to go to the Isles of Scilly. No, don't suggest that to them, they'll despair. They got through. And Yelly said the phone's ringing, and she threw it at Ed, who nearly dropped it in the bath. But he got it, and she answered, and she said, yes, when do you want to go? And he said, I'm Ed Wells. And she said, oh, I've got a coat like yours now. 3 years ago they went, and he'd got this special coat, and she found where they... So she remembered him, and it was all worth it. And they're going to go to the Isles of Scilly in August. So, you know, they kept on. And for us, sometimes we might feel despairing. But John says, continue in him, don't give up, because something wonderful is going to happen. And now, dear children, continue in him so that when he appears... When he appears, Jesus is coming back. And John doesn't say, if he appears, if Jesus comes back. He says, when Jesus comes back, when he appears. And John had spent a great chunk of his life with Jesus and then the rest of his life following him. John was an old man probably by this time. And he knew that God's words were true and faithful. And one of the things I've discovered about being old is I have proved over the years that God's word is true and you can trust him. I remember, because I was brought up in a Christian family and I thank God for it, and Dad and Mum had proved God over and over again, but I got to teenage years and I thought, well, I need to prove this for myself. And I need to trust God and see whether it works. And so I did. I took little steps and big steps, and then some of them were mad. Some things I did, I think were crazy, but God answered. I had a theory that you should never save money. You can tell that's a 19-year-old. I didn't have any money anyway, so what difference did it make? Never save money, I thought, because if you save money, you're saying, oh, God can't provide tomorrow. I'm not sure, but the fact is, God did provide. And all through my life now, I can say, God has provided. So like John, I can say God is trustworthy. And so John says, when Jesus appears, as a fact, he's coming back. And so that's important. That's why it was important to sing to Wynne this week, because her birthday's on Wednesday. If the Lord comes on Tuesday, then we don't get the chance to sing next Sunday. So make the most of every day. You see, Jesus is coming. And what will he find? What will he find us doing? Over this past 10 days, because I was isolating, I was working at home. And Alison doesn't usually see me working. She just thinks I work really hard. And now she discovers that all I do is sit on the phone and chat. And it's terrible. And I was thinking, oh, golly, she'll think I'm completely lazy, because all I'm doing is talking to my friends. And they sound like friends, actually. They hate me. They're angry. And they want me to do stuff. No, they don't hate me. But, you know, when Jesus comes, what are we going to be doing? Well, John says, live his way. And that's why I think today, being Remembrance Sunday, it is really important, isn't it, that we remember things. It's important that we remember the war and those who gave their lives. It's important because it keeps us on track. I remember, I'm sure I've told this story before, I remember going to a wedding with once, and we were, I can't remember where it was, Gloucestershire or somewhere, quite a long journey, and we stopped at some services for a cup of coffee, and we met some relations. Come from a family my size, you meet relations in most service stations, really, if there's a wedding in the area. And we sat down and we had coffee with them and we chatted. It was lovely to see them. And time went on and we shared our memories. And then Fiona, who was Jack's fiancée at the time, I think, she sort of thought, is this the way Welsh weddings go? Because she said, are we actually going to this wedding? And, oh, we'd forgotten who we were. We'd forgotten that we weren't just relations having a cup of coffee together. We were wedding guests. You see, and that's so important that we remember who we are and where we're going. And that applies to us, doesn't it? Because, listen to this. John says, don't give up, but continue in him. Now, is this another COP26 berating us for not? No. Listen to this. How great is the love the Father has lavished on us? How great is the love the Father has lavished on us? God loves you. And that is amazing, isn't it? There was a great theologian whose books I've never read, can't even pronounce his name, Karl Barth, who wrote lots of books and taught lots of people about theology and great stuff. And one of his students said to him once, can you sum up all your theology in one sentence? And he said, I can, in the words of a song that I learnt at my mother's knee. And I learnt this song at my mother's knee too. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. That, he said, sums up all of theology. If we discover we're loved, that transforms, doesn't it? It changes everything. I still remember the amazing moment when I realized that Alison loved me. I knew I loved her, but I didn't dare tell her or anything. And well, I was only 15. She was only 12. But that moment when I realized, it made such a difference. It didn't matter what other people thought of me. Still doesn't. Just to know that I'm loved is extraordinary. And to know that you're loved by a king, that would be amazing, wouldn't it? If you could say this morning, oh, the queen phoned me up and she said she's got a bad back so she can't go to Remembrance, but she just sent her love. That would be quite amazing, wouldn't it? But to be loved by the creator of the universe, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, how good is that? You see, how great is the love? And this isn't a stingy love. I love this word in this first verse of chapter 3. How great is the love the Father has lavished on us? God's love is lavish. You know, you sometimes meet people, don't you, who are lavish in their giving. Often it involves spiced chicken and rice. And it's lavish. If you get an Edith meal, it's enough for two or three days. And that's a reflection of God. And that's how people like Edith, they warm our hearts, don't they? Because they're lavish in their giving. And they remind us of God. And God, the Father. Ben said how wonderful that phrase is. And now, dear children, we have a Father who is lavish in his love. God loves you, and that's transforming. You see, if I love you, I care about the little problems of the day. Over this past 10 days when we've been, not only have I been isolating from the rest of the world, but we felt it was quite important that Alison didn't get COVID. And so we isolated from each other. Haven't done that since we were quite young. And so that meant that Alison did everything. She did all the cooking. She made all the cups of tea, because I wasn't allowed to touch anything in case she had to touch it afterwards. Oh, it was awful, but she did it because she loves me still. After 45 years marriage, she still loves me. And that's amazing, isn't it? We serve each other when we love one another. And so God, who has lavished love upon us, he cares about the small things. It was extraordinary, I found yesterday, to think that God cared about Ed and Yelly booking a campsite in Scilly. Now you could say, well, that's a luxury, come on. God isn't involved in that sort of stuff. Yes, you see, the Father is. A father loves his children. Do you remember when Adam and Eve sinned and they became aware of their nakedness? And it says God made them clothes. Isn't that amazing? Because he must have been brokenhearted. The fact that this creation, this beautiful creation he'd made, was spoiled, and they'd all become aware of sin. And yet, he made them clothes. In his love, he drew alongside them and clothed them. And you see, God does that for us, doesn't he? I've been so blessed over the past couple of years through this really difficult time, hasn't it, where the virus has caused in society huge problems. I've been so blessed by having you as my family. I think we have here something so special. It's a love that transcends gender, age, race, color, all sorts of background. We have very different lives, probably. But we are united in love because the Father has loved us, because the Father has lavished his love on us. And where else can we find compassion and help when we go through hard times? But in a family. I'm one of nine children, and there was always somebody there who could help out when I was stuck. When I got into a scrape, there was always a brother or a sister or a dad or mum, somebody who would help. And that's what families are about, isn't it? And so John says, don't give up. Don't fall into the way of thinking of the world around us. God loves you. God cares about you. He wants you. He's made you part of his family. He says, you are the children of God. Dear friends, now we are children of God, and what we will be hasn't yet been made known. But we know that when he appears, we shall be like him. We shall be like Jesus. God calls us on a journey. He calls each one of us to change a little bit, to go on a journey with him. And do you know what the point of that journey is? The point of the journey is to make us like Jesus. Sometimes journeys can be a bit uncomfortable, can't they? And sometimes things go wrong, and we don't know what's happening. Things fall apart, and we don't get the thing that we want. What's that all about? God knows, and the Father knows best. And the point of the journey is that we come to know him. And the day is coming when Jesus appears, when he calls us to be with him forever, and we will be like him. Journeys change people, don't they? I remember when Jack, our youngest son, He was only a little boy and he'd finished his A-levels and he decided he was going off to Australia. And Jack, I hope he never listens to this. He always loses everything. He used to lose his keys. He used to lose all sorts of things. And we thought, he's going off to Australia. He'll lose his passport. He'll lose his phone. He'll lose his money. And we'll never see him again. But Jack went off. And he went to Australia with a friend. And the friend then wanted to go to Asia. And Jack didn't want to. So he stayed in Australia for 6 months. And yeah, he did lose all sorts of stuff. He told us afterwards. Never told us at the time. Probably hadn't got a phone. But he went out a boy and he came back a man. That journey taught Jack something. It taught him lots of things, but taught him how to be dependent on God. That was part of Jack's walk with a journey with God. And when he came back, he was a different chap. In lots of ways, he'd grown up. And journeys do that for us. And so if you're going through a hard time, when we hear the news and it's bad news, when we struggle at work or with relationships or whatever it is, look to God and see that his love is lavishing upon us and he will bring us through this time. The psalmist could say, couldn't he, I look to the hills. I see those mountains of virus. I see the mountains of the economy. I see the mountains of relationship. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the creator of heaven and earth. You know, if we find that, if we continue with that, be sure that telephone will get answered. God will bring us to that great and wonderful day when he appears and calls us to be with him forever. And let that hope burn in our hearts so that our lives here are transformed, so that we know his joy, his hope, his peace, even through the troubles. Let's pray together. Our loving God and Father, we do thank you for the love that you've lavished upon us. You've given us freedom, forgiveness, relief. You've given us one another, and you've made us a part of your family. Oh Lord, help us in these days when the world is finding life so difficult to share the joy and the message of your love, that others will come to know you and to know your love lavished upon them, because we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Tim. Isn't it good to know that God lavishes his love on us? And in response to that, shall we stand and sing before we celebrate communion? Bless the Lord, O my soul. A chance to bring our lives before God as God has poured his life for us. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I'll worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song
again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship Your holy name. You're rich in love and You're slow to anger. Your name is great and Your heart is kind. For all Your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship Your holy name. And on that day when my strength is failing, the angel's near and my time has come, still my soul will sing Your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship Your holy name. Yes, I worship Your holy name. Yes, I worship Your holy name.
Sit down. See what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God. And how do we know that? How do we know He's lavished His love on us? Well, there's so many different ways, and I'm sure, just as Tim has shared many stories of his experience, you've got many stories. But probably the story that reminds us most of all that God has lavished His love on us is the story that's told in the bread and the wine that we're now going to share. We know God loves us because He gave His Son for us, who gave His life for us. Heavenly Father, we thank You for this bread, which reminds us of Jesus' body broken for us, that our brokenness may be fixed, that we may be healed, restored, forgiven. Thank You for His body given for us. Amen. as we celebrate the joy of Christ's love for us, the Father's love for us, of the Spirit's love for us, seen in Jesus giving his life for us, then maybe there's also an encouragement, a challenge too, that like him, we may pour out our lives in love for others, those that the Father has made and loves more than we can ever imagine. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this cup that reminds us of Jesus' life poured out for us, his blood shed. Lord, in a world where we shed each other's blood in anger all too frequently, Father, we pray that by your Spirit, you would inspire us and help us to be transformed and live lives like Christ's, pouring out our love, not anger, on those around us. Amen. The blood of Christ shed for us. Heavenly Father, as we draw to a close this part of our worship, as we turn towards the final song and our conversation, and then leaving to go out into the week to begin the next phase of our worship, we thank you for your Son who gave his life for us. And we pray now about the week to come, different places and situations we'll find ourselves in, the people we'll be with. Help us to pour out our lives of love for them as a response to how Christ has given his life for us. May we be a people of peace bringers, of hope givers, of joy sharers, as we live out our lives this week for you. Amen. Sing this song of gladness, give my praise to the fountain of delights, for in my helplessness you heard my cry, and waves of mercy put down on my life.
voice of my Redeemer. I will sing of the blood that never fails, of sins forgiven, of conscience cleansed, of death defeated and life without end. Beautiful Savior, wonderful Counselor, clothed in majesty, Lord of history, you're the way, the truth, the life, star of the morning, glorious in holiness. You're the risen one, heaven's champion, and you reign over all. I long to be where the praise is never ending, yearn to dwell where the glory never fades, where countless worshippers will share one song, and cries of worthy will honor the Lamb. You're a beautiful Savior, a wonderful Counselor, clothed in majesty, Lord of history. You're the way, the truth, the light, star of the morning, glorious in holiness. You're the risen one, heaven's champion, and you reign over.
I will trust in the cross of my Redeemer. I will sing of the blood that never fails, of sins forgiven and conscience cleansed, death defeated and life without end. Glorious lines to finish with, aren't they? Death defeated, life without end. Let us go, knowing God's love, to live and share him this week. Shall we finish with the words of the grace? May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. Amen.